How is everybody doing? And welcome back for another Strength Chat episode. Today, I have got a very special guest for you all. Today, I'm joined by a strength conditioning coach with over two decades of experience coaching across multiple sports. Today, I'm joined by the one and only John Noonan. How are you doing?
I'm very well, thank you. How are you, mate?
I am not so bad. I know we chatted a little bit briefly before started recording, but how are you? What have you been up to? What's been happening in your world recently?
What's been happening recently? Well, I have become somewhat of a travelling coach of late, especially this side of the year, it must be said. But yeah, very fortunate to have a very full and busy life at the moment. We've got three young children at home that need a lot of attention and managing. And on top of that, I guess you could say I'm coaching full-time currently within motorsport, but within that as well, I also run my own business of Noonan Performance and consult with elite athletes, principally individuals at this stage, and then some other sort of group outside of sport organisations and some executive work as well. So, yeah, pretty full, pretty varied, but very fulfilling nonetheless.
Ah, nice. And have you got? I know obviously the travel schedule has been a little bit hectic this year. Have you got more traveling coming up sort of later on in the year? Have you got a little bit of downtime now? Well, not much downtime if we've got three kids at home, but have you got much more travel on the horizon?
Yes. So I'm working, I guess one of the major roles that I've got at the moment is that I work with a number of the young Mercedes drivers. So I'll spend a lot of time with a Formula 2 driver in particular. And for those who maybe aren't that aware of sort of the junior categories in motorsport, at least I think most people are on vogue with what Formula 1 is these days, thanks to say things like Netflix, and you know that draws a lot of attention these days. But I work with a Formula 2 driver in Frederik Vesti, and in Formula 2 they have 14 race events, a couple of test events, and for folks like Fred as well who are on the trajectory of trying to get into F1, you have other opportunities outside of that as well within Mercedes where you attend certain test events or reserve driver events, those sorts of things. So the year is pretty full and busy. We travel mainly in Europe, also the Middle East. Actually, we're in the US, sorry, Australia of recent as well, for an event which is new for us on this calendar. But yeah, it's a very busy chat calendar, certainly quite congested this side of the year so far before the international start to happen. So we'll race and travel the same weekends as F1. So we're always, it's a bit like going to watch Ed Sheeran. He's the F1 act. And then you'll see a warm-up act, which is Formula 1 or, sorry, Formula 2 or Formula 3. Even the women's series, we're all on site and we kind of like rotate on and off as a schedule. So the fans get quite a lot to see, and we just sort of rotate around the rest of it really. So.
Ah, cool. Plenty to keeping you on with. And I know obviously I did quite a, quite a brief introduction there. But for anyone listening who might not know your background, how you got involved in coaching, how you got involved in sort of like the motorsport, but also the other sports that you've worked with, just want to give a little bit of a introduction to yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. I guess I'm a bit of a gypsy coach, really. I've traveled a lot and been fortunate to experience a lot of different environments and different codes. And I think for me, fundamentally, you know, most of us start at the university setting, at least you want to kind of work in the professional end of strength and conditioning, because, you know, the barriers to entry is that you've got to have a degree of some sort, at least a good standing of education, and that you're trying to gather some credible, you know, evidence to say that you are eligible to work at the top end. And that's where I kind of started, really. I mean, before that, actually, I was working in gyms, and that was great, because for me, the passion is helping people, understanding people, and trying to move people motivationally through their own journey. And once I'd gotten bored to an extent of just working in the gym setting and wanting a bit more challenge, of course, I was learning the depths of physiology and biomechanics, and that was really exciting to me. So trying to implement some of those higher end strategies for someone who just wants to, you know, get a bit fit or lose a bit of weight doesn't really align that well to some sort. So that's when I wanted to push on, and I managed through an internship to work at Scunthorpe United Football Club at the time, who were in the Championship, and that was with University of Hull. And that was a really great experience, in at the deep end, very young coach working with an average older age of the squad, I should say. And that taught me a lot of lessons, not least how to coach, but how to understand and how to support and provide a suitable service. But that was really, really cool to cut my teeth. And then kind of from there, went on and had another couple of other football opportunities, worked down at Chelsea, for example, which was wonderful. And then, as we were talking before, rugby then came a knocking, really. And my first experience was in the academy at Leeds Carnegie before they've reformed now as Yorkshire Carnegie. Met a lot of close friends who I still have today, actually, from that setting. And that was a wonderful time where, as we kind of, I guess, the stigma goes, really, in football, you have a great opportunity to work within a discipline and dive deep into a discipline and certainly work pitch based on a heavy level. But in rugby, obviously, there's a huge requirement now, or there always has been, really, but a growing requirement in the weight room, the strength training and power training and speed development. And that really, at the time when I was coaching around 2008, 2009, there was a more calling for that. So it felt like a more complete experience. And so I got my teeth into that domain and was fortunate to then lead the first team program. And then at the time I was working on the side with a snowboard athlete, and that ended up being a bit of a full-time role eventually, where I left rugby and went to work for Snowboard Cross under the umbrella of British Ski Snowboard, a little bit of alpine skiing, then headed up the freestyle ski sport Winter Olympic program for Pyeongchang. So, the guys who do these crazy jumps off these big kickers, somersault in the air and land. That was a really cool but very, very different environment from team sport. And yeah, sort of continued to collect a number of individual clients on the side before I then went back into rugby, this time in Super League with Huddersfield Giants, and then back into football. And the turning point of where we are today, really, is that we'd had our first child in 2017, and I can't explain it, but overnight there was this need to be more available, have more choice, a bit more freedom about what I was doing with my lifestyle, my career. And then I set up on my own and started to work for Hinton Performance, which is where the motorsport sits today. And that's kind of grown as well. So yeah, right now I'm consulting time with Hinton and then also running my own stuff on the side. So yeah, it's been quite a varied experience.
Ah, cool. Plenty of different things there as well, and this kind of leads quite nicely into the first question or first topic that I wanted to chat about, really, is that when a lot of potentially younger coaches or people looking to get involved in strength and conditioning, you kind of think of strength and conditioning of like what you mentioned there, rugby, football, and field based sports, whereas talking about sort of like the winter sports and the motor sports as well. What does strength conditioning look like, for that? What does the training, what does the coaching look like? Because you can take things from most field sports and adjust them and tweak them and apply them to other field-based sports, because there's still some elements that you've got to be able to apply, whereas for other sports that aren't maybe I don't know whether mainstream is the right word, but with it is in front of mind. How does that look in terms of problem solving, finding solutions, and getting making an impact on that athlete's performance?
Definitely. Look, I think you make a really relevant point because you're right. I think most graduate coaches coming into the field do as I did, that you get lured by the lights of Premier League football, Guinness Premiership rugby. And that's certainly the settings that I wanted to be in. I mean, I don't mind sharing that inside my first 3 to 5 years, I was looking at football, looking at rugby, had some great opportunities off the bat. And I wanted to go and work at England rugby. Like that was going to be the pinnacle role for me. But it just didn't map out that way. But not least, I found myself stepping into different environments and roles that aligned with me from a point of passion and fulfillment. And I guess in some ways, my choices of careers and roles, the roles that I've had within my career have kind of aligned with what I was like in sport as well. I was always quite varied. I was very happy to go and flirt with different sports when I was younger. Wasn't married necessarily to one. Probably the larger mainstay was football at different periods in time, but that's because of where my network and demographic were going as well. And I guess would go with the crowd a little bit there. But for me, it didn't really matter that I had to just live in one sport because, well, that I'm the guy for that. I'm the one who's got the most experience in this. It was more about who are the people and do they align with the things that I'm interested in, so to speak? Do we share similar values, a similar ethos in the way that we want to work? Are they passionate in the same way that I'm passionate about being, the best in your field, offering value, making sure that people are doing good work? Are we doing projects that are exciting and fulfilling as well? And as long as we have those synergies, at least for me, that was a kind of a lucid tick box that even subconsciously, I was just kind of drawn to. And then second, you know, the point that you make that for sure that, you know, I think we're all, you know, folks that are at least watching competitive football, rugby, or have maybe probed around the fields of what those roles look like, probably have a fairly good grasp of, you know, we recognize that we want to optimize on-field performance all the time and that on-field performance is king. And the other conduits of, you know, strength training, recovery, nutrition, sleep, etc., those things are there to augment our physical preparation and or recovery from the main event itself. I think we all can agree on that. And to be honest, it's no different from, you know, the likes of Winter Olympic snow sport or even motorsport today. I think you need to have a fundamental handle and understanding of what are the key demands that we're preparing people for. Like, are you keeping the main thing the main thing? So to use motorsport as an example, the sport really, really, really amplifies the importance of the car. And, you know, as a physical preparation practitioner, I can have minimum influence on the car. I'm not an engineer, nor should I profess to try and get stick my foot in that area. But I need to have an understanding about what are some of the key things that they're talking about, so that the driver, you know, there's a relevant link there between the two, and that they're sharing good practice, they're communicating effectively. But I need to physically get this guy ready for what the season looks like on a broader scale, what one portion of the season might look like for, you know, a less congested, say, schedule or a really congested schedule like we have at the moment. What are the worst case demands to prepare them for? And then what are the key things that we can control physically and nutritionally and from a recovery point of view, biomechanically, and psychologically? And one of the great things about stepping into a space where you're more of a performance coach rather than just an S&C coach is that you holistically have a license to have conversations about all the things that matter and all things that feed into being your best on a race day. So then, therefore, of course, we're, you know, away from the track, we're doing the heavy lifting, we're spending time in the gym area, such as you would with a football player, rugby player. It's similar. But of course, they've got very different body composition requirements. They're very light, these guys in particular, because they don't want to be heavy. We're not trying to hit people hard like in rugby. But we need to be incredibly aerobic fit because they're going to work at roughly 80% of their max heart rate for at least an hour or 2 hours in the car at one time. So these guys are fit athletes. You know, they're not as fit as your super endurance cyclists or your marathon runners, but their VO2s are up there. Equally, they need to be, you know, we know that having higher amounts of maximum strength make them more resilient to the multifaceted demands of travel, training, racing, a lot of airplane travel that they have to do as well. And that if you're a stronger individual, fitter individual, you're going to recover faster as well from those particular events or travel demands. And then, you know, we want to make sure that we've got adequate fueling recovery strategies in place, that we're hydrating suitably because we race in hot ambient temperatures a lot as well, especially when we go to the Middle East. And, you know, we're racing in places like Jeddah, where we were recently in Saudi Arabia. It was like 30 degrees, 50 degrees on track. And, you know, they're sat in front of an engine as well that's producing a lot of heat. So once you kind of break down what are those key determining factors that could hamper someone's performance or hurt them from performing at their best, you know, I'll focus my time very much on those areas. And then I guess the lesser spoken skills or things that we're educating ourselves about as S&C coaches is in the psychology. I mean, I think we'd all, to a point, have a common sense where we can understand if someone's stressed or having a hard time. And we'll have a conversation about, you know, how are you getting on at the moment? How are things? You look like you're struggling a bit here. Talk to him about that. Help me understand. You know, I'm one of the few people around this small team that we have around a driver that is probably close enough from a relationship point of view to just have a general open conversation without trying to get into the nitty-gritty of, you know, implementing things that I'm not sure about or attacking things that a psychologist would, you know, frankly deal with. But everyone around that area, such as your team sport people as well, actually, from your kit men to your physio to anyone, they're all giving unsolicited advice. So, you know, just having an open conversation to say, listen, I'm here if you want to talk about something. And if I've got the answers, great. If I haven't, then let's try and guide and get some support from someone else. And what we do at Hints of Performance is we will open opportunities within, you know, the case needs of certain athletes or professionals that we work with. And we'll bring in a specialist like a performance psychologist. And that's something that we do. So we'll build a strategy away from the race weekend or the track, and then I may facilitate delivery of that or continuation of that on track. So you do feel like you're having a kind of a meaningful touch on a number of areas, as well as carrying their bags and making sure they've got the meals at the right times. You know, you're kind of a dog's body as well, but it's challenging on a number of levels, which is very refreshing if you've spent a lot of time in one domain particularly, and you want to sort of spread your wings or your value in different areas. But yeah, to the core of your question, really, you're doing some very, very similar things. What you look to appreciate, what are the key demands? You look to prepare hard for the key demands, and you look to evaluate success against how your preparation stacked up to the delivery of performance, and then you iterate from there.
Yeah, because I think that was a good explanation of that, because it comes down to that, you know, that needs analysis you said there, you know, understanding. You need to have a, because I think a lot of people, you know, for myself, having played rugby, is that thought process of, yeah, I'm just gonna coach rugby. I'm that's all that, that that's all I'm going that's all I'm going to do. Whereas actually, you know, sometimes other things come up, and you know, you've got to adjust to different things. Similar to, you know, I know a couple of people listening might be training different clients, you know, in terms of some want to do powerlifting or fat loss or muscle building or whatever it may be. I think looking at, and you kind of mentioned this at the start of, you know, getting to understand the psychology of the person, and you know, an all-round approach, if you like, and from the team sports that you've worked in, but also the individual sports that you've worked in as well. The end product is, you know, how they perform in terms of, you know, how much impact what we do in the gym, the conversations, managing their stress and nutrition. How much does one have more impact on another compared to in a team setting where there's a lot more different individuals and a lot more people? There's 15 different personalities in rugby, as opposed to the driver that you're working with, where you've got to kind of like really get to know them. Does that differ? Does it have different impacts? If that kind of makes sense.
Yeah, I think one of the key differences there really is, you know, when you're working as a coach or you're a lead coach within a group program, a team program, you feel, I think, responsible to try and have a touch point with every individual. You know, I would make it a point of mine when everyone would come into the building, when I was working Leeds Carnegie particularly, that someone would walk in the door and I'd look to engage each person, and my first point of call was to try to help or have an impact on that person, that they would leave that conversation or that interaction to go, yeah, John's all right, he cares. And it was just that touch point first of have a personal relationship, strike a rapport, because I knew if I did that, in a way, it's kind of like befriending or manipulation, isn't it? Because you know that you're going to ask certain things of that individual that sometimes that they might not necessarily want to do, which is, or do me a favor, just fill in your wellness questionnaire this morning, would you? Or just come and give us a jump test over here, would you? Or, you know, I'm going to have to push you today, and there's intervals. You know, you don't like doing them, but like this is really important for you. If you start with a point of, I think you show that an individual that you're willing to understand what they're about, what their interests are, but what problems that they have as well, and that you're creating a place and a relationship where they can come and share something with you, be that positive or negative, you're going to have a more compliant individual who's willing to do the tough stuff for you or show up in times when it really matters. And frankly, for their teammates as well. If you can try to strike that way of behaving within a culture, it pays dividends in how far people are willing to go. I probably learned the hard way, I think, early doors, where, you know, I was of the, because I was into the depths of physiology, and I was very much, I think, I would lead with quite an academic front in the way that I would program, and felt that, oh, the winning teams are the best teams that have the best programs. And you recognize the more that you work with people that programs don't beget people, people beget programs. And if you get that balance right, you have a common respect and a language that is just human. And I think if you work on the human first, you can get far more progress down the line with other things that are considered more performance or a bit more sexy. And frankly, the differences between your groups and your individuals is that you just get more opportunity more often to get a little bit deeper with a particular person or a smaller group at any one time. We'll have a small performance team around one individual, but we're all in one place to try and enable one person to deliver their best at any one time when it matters the most. And For me, working with an individual, it's just highlighted or magnified the importance of having good fundamental relationships first that are just generally taken care of. Is this person okay? Do they know that I'm showing up for them? And then we can talk business afterwards. That's kind of the beginning, middle, and end for me, to be honest with you.
Yeah, one thing, and this might be a little bit of a tangent, but just as you were chatting there, and it's a little bit like when we spoke about kind of your background and introduction. A lot of especially when people are working in professional sport have degrees, a science background. There's a lot of information, a lot of literature and reviews, and you look at the science and being seen as a professional, whereas on the like the personal training side of things, the entry point is you can do your level three, and then actually you don't really have to do much stuff else after that. You could just have that and then go from there. Do you think that sometimes because there is that science element, the degrees that that people have, that sometimes people focus more on the science side of things and the numbers and the tech that's involved, as opposed to actually I don't know whether it's the softer skills or the art of coaching, if you like, to be able to, yes, we've got this knowledge in terms of biomechanics, physiology, and programming, but if the athlete doesn't like you and don't want to do the stuff that you're asking them to do, it's kind of, all right, well, I'm stuck now because I've got all this technology, I've got all this knowledge, but I can't see if it's working or implemented it because I don't know how to speak to the athletes, if that kind of makes sense.
Yeah, that I think spot on, and I think today, I'm not working in a team environment on the ground in a building where I go to work in the same place every day as I used to. And I think when you're in those settings, you have a real I used to have a real visceral sense of what is this culture all about. And I define culture really as this is how people behave around here. It's synonymous with what's their attitude, what's their character, what's their ethos toward work, how do they communicate with each other. That's kind of my culture definitions really. And when you're thinking about whether or not you're playing the right part within a culture or helping steer a culture, particularly if you're in a leadership position or you're seen as someone that commands a role like that, I think there's two environments that I've come across, that three actually, that are really defining and help you see a great sense of, am I getting this balance right between, the seeing someone as a person or seeing someone just as a unit, as a number on my spreadsheet that I have to engage with, or I have to get GPS from, or I have to optimize from a, physiological point of view. It's that the three environments for me were the youth setting, because when you're speaking to, the likes of 12 to 14-year-olds, especially if you can't engage fundamentally, just engage with a young person, a young developing person, they're not interested in anything that you've got to offer, be that helping someone improve, like a football player, like improve their hip mobility, like we're doing warm-ups, or to get them to understand the importance of trying to get in good body positions to demonstrate or deliver a squat properly. Like they're not even on the same wavelength. So, a lot of times we would have to do a lot of play to get some energy out of them, to kind of establish some focus. But for them to go, oh, this guy's all right, yeah, okay, I'm willing to give you a bit of time. What do you want me to do? Oh, okay, yeah, I'm willing to work hard now for you because you understand me and you can create the right setting for me. Similarly, rugby league, it's a cutthroat setting. I've worked in one environment in particular, and I had a quite a hard time there because I do fundamentally want to show up for people and I want to try and build a rapport with people, and I also recognize that not everyone wants to be your best friend, and that's fine as well. But there were certain settings there where people were just a little bit hard-faced at times, didn't necessarily want to build a relationship and just wanted to come and do the job and get off, and didn't necessarily have the right application in certain days when it was needed. And this isn't for all rugby league environments, so absolutely not, because I was in one recently, dropped into Melbourne Storm, and that was a wonderful example of a culture that cares deeply about each other and the mission that they're all on and all pulling in the right direction. And that was really refreshing to see in that setting particularly. But the rugby league environment was one that if you didn't strike a rapport or get the trusted individual, there was no way you could talk about, your periodization or whatever you wanted to deliver within a program that you felt was going to move people or move the needle. And then third setting was freestyle snow sport. These guys got really, really good at their sport, hanging out, what they call backcountry, which is just, off-piste riding, skate parks, just messing around, very free-spirited individuals, not default within academy settings through to first team environments whatsoever. And again, it was, is this guy all right? Is he cool? Can we trust him? Oh, okay. So what is this? What's this squat that you want me to do, or this wave loading you're talking about? Or you had to just break down those individual perceptions of, oh, he's another sports scientist or another strength guy, and oh, he's a bit busy, this guy, or that kind of thing. If you get past that, you're all right. And there's if anyone sort of throws in trust equation into Google, you'll see this. What is trustworthiness? And essentially, it's the breakdown of credibility plus relationships plus intimacy divided by self-orientation. So if number one, you've got to have good credible credentials to stand up in front of someone, and you've got to know what you're talking about. But that's got to be bridged with, does this guy show up again and again and deliver the information in the right way? And also, does he deliver it in a way that I can understand? Is it intimate enough for what this relationship or this setting needs right now? And then is it aligned with who that person is, what their interests and what their ambitions are? And if it isn't on that particular day, then maybe try going a different way the next time around. But if you can hold that front and center and break down any obstacles or, obstructions to progress, then you can get the progress that you want afterwards. But yeah, it's definitely human first.
Yeah, absolutely. And just one thing, actually, because it's interesting you said about Melbourne stand. So I used to live in Melbourne for a little bit. I went to go see Melbourne stand quite a lot. And what I found interesting when you spoke there about culture and everyone pulling in the same direction, I can't remember what season it was. But basically, the Melbourne team, did they move to the Gold Coast because Melbourne was in lockdown to still play the game? So they're away from the families, and they ended up going on a really good run. I don't know whether they actually won the NRL, because I know Penrith have won it for the last 2 years, I think. But I think that's a good environment of when you put something and find, this is a massive tangent, but when you've got those challenges like that, you can either pull together. And one book that I really enjoyed reading talking about culture was I don't know whether you've read it, it's called The Barcelona Way. And it's kind of like there's a bit in the book where they're all going for food, and there was Pep Guardiola was watching people put food on the plate. It was like a self-serving buffet, and he was watching the players who would like absolutely stack their food up, stack food up on their plate, compared to other players that would like look to get another spoonful and think, oh, actually, I want to leave some for my other teammates. And then he was like, right, this is how I'm going to build my team around them, because they've already got that buy-in in terms of that culture. Which I think all that side of stuff, when you mentioned before about, the psychology side of things of working with clients, with athletes, within settings, I think that whole idea of you either create a culture or become part of a culture, because it could be easy just to go in and just be like, oh, well, this is what we do here. Okay, sound. That's what we're going to do. Whereas, actually, that can be changed by, getting to know what motivates them to be able to build from there. One thing that I wanted to touch on as well, again, going back to, always the overriding thing is the performance in whatever sport the athlete or the client is doing. And there's always a talk about kind of like efficiency, because there isn't time. You might not have a lot of time with the athlete, or travel schedule, or anything like that. How do you balance the training side of things to get done what you need to do to make sure that they're robust enough for performance, and that they're going to be able to perform on the field, in the car, on the slopes, if you like, on the snowboard? That's some of my limited knowledge about winter sports, but compared to taking that time to know what makes them tick and how to get the best out of them, if that makes sense, kind of merging them together.
I think that's where, by and large, you've got to default to the team. I think So the winter sport is a really good example. When I came into that setting, I was very aware that I was number one viewed as a fish out of water, and I wasn't walking around in board shorts and throwing out hand signs, and I was different, and that was very, very clear. But I was brought into that environment by, a management group that felt actually we need someone that's credible enough within physical preparation to prepare athletes more, because we're getting hurt too often. It means we can't get on the snow enough to practice our sport, which means we're not making the skill progressions to then arrive at competition and go, right, we have a group or a number of athletes available to throw down what we believe will be medal winning performances right now, or tricks. And that was, it's kind of, well, I guess two things within that. Number one, it's what is the mission and or the objective that you've been given? Is there then the scope, the feasibility, the resource, the time, and the opportunities to then deliver against the objectives that are then underpinning the strategy that you have? So, I think once you recognize what the mission is there and what your purpose within that mission is, you can then work to a spectrum of these are the non-negotiables that you have. So, if you can go from macro to micro, but we knew that we had a 4-year period, for example, within Winter Olympics. We knew that every season would have certain schedule requirements upon them, which would then free up certain opportunities for training. But we also would understand the bigger picture from a strategy point of view, which was we need to be less injurious, and we need to make sure that physically we are making the relevant progressions to make sure that we can stand up to do sufficient number of periods of training, time on snow, and develop the skills and course with that. Like I mentioned before, I think the main thing always is the main thing, and that's making sure that the skill requirements, the technical developments that have to take place to deliver the performance through the technical competencies, that has to be held as the main thing. So we would build our strength and conditioning program around the technical program, if you will, or the skill development program for the Winter Olympic sport. And then I would then come forth and make some recommendations with, well, we need to get this many exposures if we can to the weight room. This is the program overarching. But these are the tactics that we're going to employ for each one of these individuals based on their injury history or their physical requirements based on what we've gathered in baseline testing. And then you would send you forth your thesis there. And then the other area that I think I started to touch on briefly then thereafter was, if you're coming into an environment where, like I was, a fish out of water, I wasn't this free spirited, off the wall, adrenaline junkie. I was coming in a, kind of like viewed to be the guy with the clipboard almost. Like, he's interested in my physical readiness. What's that? He wants me to do some jump testing weekly. What's that about? And I want to get in the gym. I don't really want to get in the gym. To fast forward some of the obstacles that you face there that may be going to hinder progress or hinder achieving some of the objectives that you've got in mind, is to then use other parts of the team to deliver those messages for you that already have the trustworthiness that I mentioned before. They already have the reliability, the intimacy, the credibility, and the athletes know that they're there on their needs because they have some, long-standing relationships. So I would deliver a lot of my messages through the physio, who was already a trusted advocate, but now that physio was also sending the same messages that I wanted to say. Listen, that your knee keeps getting a bit sore because you're not quite strong enough to manage some of the impacts that you're hitting when you do land, or you don't quite, get a smooth landing that you're looking for, and maybe you knuckle it and you nail yourself a few times. Do you know what? I think you should get in the gym with John and just give it a couple of sessions and see how you feel after that. And sure enough, you start to introduce people to things that they do physically need, and you start to see that change take place. And then the penny drops, and then they recognize that actually you can add a bit of value, and you therefore can be someone that they can rely upon or an asset. And before you know it, that it trickles on from there. And I would kind of also make it my business, especially within teams where you knew that there were going to be certain architects of an environment or a culture, to go, if I can influence you, I think I'll knock down the dominoes and get a few more of you to follow. And so I would almost cherry pick a few of the influences as well. You across a rugby team, for example, you knew the ones that you could look at, the ones who always wanted to do a bit less, or the other ones who were polar opposite, they always wanted to do a bit more, or the one in the middle that just wanted to do enough and had a decent handle on, listen, I think, John, we're creaking here a little bit. I think you can afford to push us a bit more. Find your barometers, your Goldilocks of the groups as well. And then also heed the advice off that. And I must admit, it took me a while as a young coach to get out of my own way and not just believe that everything I knew or the textbook told me was going to be right for this certain group or person, and just be happy at times to go, listen, I'm thinking this, but I'm really interested to see what you think. Do you think we can afford to push at the moment? Do you think, aside all the metrics of heart rate variability, resting heart rate and sleep and all that sort of stuff, before I look at those numbers first, let me ask this person. I think they've got a really good handle on where he's at, but also what the group needs. And equally with leaders in different athletic environments, to go, how do you think I can best get that person on board? Because I'm aware that they don't quite like doing the strength work thing. And, I think it could be good for them, or I think a warm-up might be really, really good for this group. What do you think? What do you think? Where do you think we could start? And just allowing the group or the individuals to steer the decisions that you make as well. And I would often try that and make a lot more progress, surprisingly, more so than I did from my own sort of, this is the path I must follow because, my philosophy says so, whatever.
Do you think that's one of the kind of lessons that that coaches need to learn, that or what you've found for a successful culture or environment in terms of having, like what you mentioned there, asking the physio to be like, get that message across. You're still doing your working towards your objective or mission, if you like, but having that collaborative approach with the people that are there, rather than thinking, I'm the performance coach, I'm the S&C coach, this is my area, this is what I'm gonna, and people are gonna listen to me. Is that sometimes an area that is could actually hinder the performance because it isn't that collaborative approach?
Very much so. I mean, I almost steal the mantra off of a quite a famous book, Ego is the Enemy. I certainly was, when I had head S&C coach as my title, I think within my first few months of at least Carnegie, because I'd had an experience of a first team S&C coach within football, and thought, right, okay, I need to established leadership. What's that look like? Well, it needs to be authoritative. It needs to be loud at times, maybe. It needs to be quite autocratic. I need to have direction. I need to inspire people with that, and I'm sure they will follow. And you quickly learn when you're trying to speak to people that are older than you, if you haven't quite balanced your message in the right way, even your tonality's off, you are going to struggle to get people to buy in, listen, and comply. And before you know it, you're not able to deliver what you've got down as your thesis. So I think experience, making mistakes should tell you a lot, absolutely, in that area for sure. And frankly, the longer I've been in sport, whether it be working in groups or whether it be working with individuals like we are right now, success is a team. Like, even if you do have all the answers, at times you can make far more progress or far more impact and have better value if you recognize that actually that particular message that you think you've got and you can offer doesn't need to be given by you. It should be delivered by somebody else. And allowing someone else to step in, or giving someone, or empowering someone who maybe works as an assistant to you, to deliver that message instead, because you think that would land better or have a bit more weight, do it, because it will come back. It will come back tenfold for you further down the line, where eventually, whether it's your ego in front of you or not, that other person will come back to you and go, listen, thanks for letting us do that. And I know that you sort of drove that eventually, but now I realize it. And, that was a really, really good decision that you took. Or, I think it's recognizing there's a number of ways to get there, but you don't always have to go through route one, or, you as an individual. I think coaching is a really interesting journey. You go through, especially if you're going to work at top end in pro sport, you kind of go on this journey of working as a junior to an assistant to a senior to maybe a director or a head of performance. And perhaps the perception along that journey as well is that you become more authoritative as you step through that journey. And you absolutely can. And, by role or definition, you are seen as more of an authority in that space. But just because you're the key decision maker doesn't necessarily mean that you have to do that in a loud way. It can be done through, quiet management, or quiet leadership is as attractive as someone that's very loud and in your face. And also, one other thing I will say to that is, I went through my kind of former years as an S&C coach working in team sports. And anyone who's ever spent a lot of time in teams always know who the loudest person is. You can always see easily within a group who the funny guy is, or who the disciplinarian is, or who the workers are, who the jokers are. It reeks of it within a group. And I thought that to be someone that would be a leader, or to be accepted and a real influencer within a group, that I would have to be one of the loudest, like a peacock. And there's times when I think I played that part, but the older I've gotten as well, and I'm now 38, I've actually realized that I play more to my strengths. When I'm a bit more of an introvert, I can play the group guy at times. And sometimes you've got to command, if you're doing, let's say, a conditioning or a speed agility session on the pitch, you've got to have a loud voice. You've got to be able to stimulate and inspire. Great. But you don't always have to play that card either, or that hand, and it's recognizing how you can almost manipulate your own skill set in the right setting with the right person to have the right impact.
Yeah, definitely. I think that's everyone is going to have their own kind of like personality traits. And we run like an internship program, and obviously they can gravitate towards obviously getting a full-time position. And sometimes it's that case of as long as they're saying the right things and the end product is what we're after, I'm not too. Yeah, I'm not too bothered if they make it, say, in a jokey way, and it gets the person doing what they need to be done, or whether they're loud or anything like that. Because sometimes one of my really good mates is a coach. He just talks. I don't think I've ever heard him. I mean, he can raise his voice, if he's shouting across the gym or across the field. But he gets his point across. He still gets that message there. And I think that's similar to it's a little bit similar to with again, this might be a little bit of a tangent, but in terms of like the social media and the content side of things, not always the people that are shouting the loudest and all those sorts of things are actually necessarily giving the right answer. Because you could be really loud and boisterous and feel as though there's a lot of energy there, but there's nothing behind it. You just creating a buzz, which isn't always needed. Because again, I know we reverted back to it a couple of times, but that it's the performance is the end product, is the end product right? And that's what I thought was really good that you mentioned there, in terms of that collaborative approach, getting other people to say that message. Because ultimately, if they're when they go out on the field or the track or whatever it may be, if they perform well, all of a sudden the entire environment, wins together, or performs well together. One thing that you mentioned there, and you've mentioned quite a lot of things that you've learned from to then develop and move forward as a coach in your career as well. Do you think that it's just a natural order of events, if you like, that sometimes coaches will have to take not necessarily the wrong avenue, but a different approach to get the end product, and then think, I could have done this better, and then refined it a little bit, rather than thinking, well, I'm just going to keep doing this until it actually, just stick with it and not change anything, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I think that's the. I think it's a necessary journey that you have to do something and almost try and to a point sometimes fail at it. And I failed in countless areas, be that as a leader or be that within programming, and made countless mistakes. And they are incredibly necessary, and really it defines who you are tomorrow and next week and next year. And like, you've got to be willing to first try it to figure out that actually, if that message didn't land properly, or that program could have been done in a different way, or I didn't quite yield the impact that I was looking for, and then iterate and develop it the second time around. And that's, I think people that ultimately do that are willing to make mistakes and be vulnerable and, almost share that as well. You, a bit like, your comments that you made when we first started the call, was that you grow so much more as a person because it becomes a defining point in your learning curve, your trajectory, to know that efficiency matters here. I'm not going to do that again. And or if I want to make more progress quicker, then I do need to be willing to make some mistakes and fail at times. And I'm terrible for stuff sometimes. I'm a real, particularly with like kind of online work, I'm a real, I can be a procrastinator because I want it to be perfect. I want it to be right. And I'll hang on something for too long. And actually, you know, people talk about the mantra of do it now, you know, sweat the small stuff later and then go back and improve it the second time around. And that's fine too. And ultimately, people won't, if you're a good person, you've got good intentions, they won't hang you out to dry for making that mistake. But you certainly won't be thanked longer term if you're still making the same mistakes a year or 2 years down the line. And then you're scratching your head, wondering around said opportunities that you were hoping for or progression within your field or your organization hasn't quite come your way. So, yeah, be willing to make those mistakes and do so without fear of ego protection, I think is absolutely essential.
Yeah, I think that was a good point, really, because it goes back to kind of when you mentioned about kind of that trustworthiness, you know, and building relationships. I think the biggest thing on that is, and what I've kind of always prided myself on is that honesty. You know, I know we spoke before we started recording in terms of being that honest of I don't have the answer, but I'm going to find someone who will have the answer for you, you know, so that you know you're going to get the best answer for it. Whereas I think it's good having that honesty that okay, I didn't get it right, but this is what I'm going to do better. And I think what you said there of yeah, but if you keep getting it wrong, keep making the same mistakes, honesty kind of goes out the window because you're not actually trying to address it and find those solutions. So I think that was a good point there. Quite a lot of tangents, quite a lot of topics covered there. Really enjoyed the chat. The last question that I like to ask John is from everything that we've chatted about there, and for everyone listening, what would be your take-home points or words of wisdom?
Goodness me. I'll summarize that in 1 minute. Oh gosh. Well, I think as an aging coach or someone that's been around a bit, I think, you know, there's a lot of discussion around direction of coaching careers these days about whether you should be someone that works in team sport. Goes individual sports or works for yourself. There's a lot of discussion around the areas of, you know, making decisions aligned with your purpose or your values or your work-life balance needs and all those sorts of things. And I think that the one thing I would say in that space that links with everything we've spoken to really is that you can't beat sometimes a bit of hard work, but you should also continue to try to work smart and hard. And the reason I say that is because, you know, a little bit like your last point there, if you are relentlessly working doggedly, be that from an hour's point of view, put in on a shift or in a work environment, and you're feeling like you're getting no progress or you're not making the rate of progress that you desire, you're still going to be working doggedly hard and maybe not working or making a dent in your progress as a career coach 5 years down the line, if you expect different outcomes. You've got to respect your own time, but equally you need to respect the pathway that sometimes you have to frankly walk as a young developing coach. Coaching is hard, and there's a lot of hours required to refine your craft, to learn about yourself as well as a coach, frankly, and figure out what works, what doesn't work with groups and organizations. And you know, I have worked for free a lot of times, especially when I was, you know, a university coach, needing to try and get, you know, with an understanding of what would be an entry requirement for a paid role. You have to have experience in certain environments, show a willingness that you have tried to develop your craft and you're at least arriving in the door and you can offer some value from day one. Like that's a journey that takes time. You have to have a little bit of patience and relentless effort to do those hard yards straight up before someone gives you an opportunity. I think that we have to be careful that we don't try and eradicate the idea that hard work isn't necessary or relevant for this trade. It really is. But in the same vein, there comes a point where clearly, you know, you can't just work for free and or work crazy hours, be that with no returns, either from an experience or financial point of view. And you have to look after yourself. And that comes down to the individual to make those decisions, I think. I think certainly we should have expectations of certain environments and groups who look to, from an employability point of view, manage their staff appropriately and not take the mickey. But I think there's definitely a balance to be struck there with what our expectations are and how we show up and voice our opinions for that. And that's just my Penethworth maybe on that topic there. I think a bit, you know, a bit like what we have the arguments age old, don't we? Swinging between aerobic to anaerobic intervals, swinging between carb and no carb. Like, you know, 1 minute we're going at it and saying coaching requires getting into getting down and dirty, working at the coal face and gathering that experience. And we celebrate those who are willing to demonstrate hard work and ethos. And then we kind of polarized it the other way now and said nobody should be working for free at all. And that, you know, we shouldn't be disrespecting coaches and their credibilities and the credentials that they arrive in the door with. We shouldn't be doing either of those things. We should be trying to find a sweet spot in the middle that has a respect for people's offering in an environment and equally is willing to then return that with either experience and or financial return to invest in someone in the time that they give us. So I think it's a challenging topic, but one that needs a little bit of empathy on either end, I think.
Yeah, definitely. I think throughout the entire chat, I think there was some good take-home points and practical takeaways for a lot of coaches coming in. I know, you know, part of the reason, you know, with the podcast is also advice that I would have liked as a coach coming through. So I think there was, you know, quite a lot of useful and helpful stuff in that chat from there. Thanks again, John, for taking the time to jump on. Really, really appreciated it, taking the time to chat, and really enjoyed a lot of the topics that we've touched on there. If anyone has any questions about what we've chatted about today, see the content and information that you put out there, where could people reach out to you or find you?
Yeah, for sure. So knocking around social media a bit. So John Noonan Coach would be the handle on Instagram in particular. I'm not on Twitter that much these days. I can't really be doing with it, if I'm honest with you. email is john@noonanperformance.com and you can find me there as well.
Awesome. Again, thanks a lot for taking the time to jump on. Thanks a lot to everyone listening, and I will see you all next week.